Hi everyone and welcome to another video. Today I have a Lenovo ThinkStation S20 here in front of me. In this video, I will completely disassemble then reassemble this machine. And while doing the reassembly, I will also take the opportunity to upgrade the CPU, memory and disks as this one came without any drives. Once all of that is done and the PC still works, I will do some benchmarking as well. The ThinkStation S20 is a workstation. The idea of this type of PC is to have powerful near-server level hardware in a desktop enclosure for professional power users that simply do not have enough resources using a regular desktop or laptop. The model I have, machine type 4105, has an Intel Xeon W3503, which I believe was one of the entry-level CPUs at the time. It still has the original 6GB of RAM in 3x2GB modules to take full advantage of the triple channel support. A quick look in the case also showed me that there is an Nvidia Quadro 600. Let's take a look at the outside before we dive in. The design is pretty nice. It gives you the feeling that this is not just your regular office PC for sure. The front of the tower has a DVD drive and a free bay, card reader, two USB ports, front audio and a power button. On the back, we can see the power connector, eSATA, digital audio in and out, a serial port, 8 more USB ports, network, more audio and a video card. And there is also a pair of keys here. These keys are used to open up the side panel. The whole mechanism gives a nice quality feeling. On the inside then, we can see the 625 watt power supply, CPU and cooler, video card, the 6 memory slots and 3 bays for hard drives. While we are here, let's start the disassembly by removing the video card first. A nice Nvidia Quadro 600. Not cheap at all at the time. Next up are the power connectors to the motherboard. ATX, P4, and the proprietary 10-pin connector next to the CPU. Near this one is also the case fan. Then the SATA cables. And the rest of these smaller connectors to the motherboard. First the card reader, front USB, LEDs, front panel, thermal sensor, front audio, and speaker. The DVD drive is the next one to remove. First, the other end of that SATA cable. And power. Then we need to remove the front panel first. And we slide out the DVD drive like this. Since everything is disconnected, we can proceed with removing the motherboard from the case now. It's held to the backplate with 9 screws. After removing these, we can get a board out. From the board, we can then remove the memory, 3x2GB as mentioned. Last thing on the motherboard is the CPU, which is under the CPU cooler, so we need to remove that one first. That thermal paste has seen better days, I believe. So let's clean that up a bit. Same for the CPU fan, of course. As mentioned, here you see the Xeon W3503, which was in the machine. Not really the best CPU of choice at the time. My plan is to replace this one with this X5670, which I still have, but I'm not sure if it still works. In case it doesn't, I will use this X5650, which I know is good. As you can see in this comparison, the X5650 and X5670 only differ between each other in terms of clock speed. Compared with the W3505, on the other hand, the difference is huge. 6x as much threads, 3x as much cache, support for more and faster memory, and all of that with less power consumption. Before putting the CPU on it, let's first have a better look at the motherboard. Let's start with the CPU socket. We have 6 memory slots for 3 memory channels. The blue one is always first, starting closest to the CPU. So this is the order. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here we have the PCIe slots, 2x16, and the physical X16, which is only X4, an X1, and the regular PCI slot. For power, we have the ATX connector, P4 connector, and a 10-pin proprietary connector. We also have 5 SATA connectors, a floppy drive connector, case and CPU fans. On the bottom of the motherboard, we can find a speaker, front audio, PS2, thermal sensor, front panel and LEDs, drive LEDs, one more fan connector, the SATA ports again, front USB, and a card reader. Before we start the reassemble, let's look at what we have. The original memory, 3x2GB, 3 additional 4GB DDR3 modules, CPU and cooler, SSD and 2x1TB, video card, DVD drive, and the motherboard. Reassembly time. First up is our new old CPU. We can simply open up the socket, make sure we have the CPU orientation correct, then insert it and close the socket again. Of course, we need to put a bit of fresh thermal paste, and we can put back the CPU cooler. For the memory, as mentioned, we first need to use the blue slots. I will, for now at least, only put the 3 new modules as these work at a faster speed. Time to put the motherboard back in the case. Once it is fixed, we can put back the smaller connectors on the bottom of the case, starting with a card reader and front USB, followed by the speaker, front audio, thermal sensor, front panel, and LEDs. Let's connect the power supply as the next step. Starting with that 10-pin connector, which is in a very annoying place. The P4 connector, followed by the ATX connector itself. As you can see, the power supply also has additional PCIe connectors, which would allow you to put in a proper video card, and the power supply definitely has a capacity for that as well. Next, I will put in the hard disks. They need to be installed in these flexible trays. The disk fits in easily, and then we can just put the tray back. Same for the second disk. The SSD I will put below the trays as the space available there is a good match. Now we can connect these three to power. And connect the SATA cables. Now that's done, we're almost there. The last component to install is the video card. Then all that's left is to put back the front panel and close up the case. Time to power everything up. At least that's what I thought. Not much is happening and no beeps either. My suspicion that the X5670 was bad is probably right. Let me do a quick replace of that one with the known good X5650 instead. Here we go again. Aha, that looks better. Let's have a quick look in the BIOS to be sure it is. We see the X5650 being detected properly and the 12GB of RAM running at 1333MHz as we want it to be. We don't see any of the drives being detected, but that's expected as the SATA ports have been configured for RAID. In the option ROM of the RAID controller, we do see the disks, and let's hit Ctrl-I to enter the configuration utility. Here I will go for option 1 and create the RAID 0 array of those 1TB disks. There we are, and let's continue the boot process to Windows now. We still do not see the RAID volume yet, but let's first have a look at Task Manager. Here we see the new CPU and its 6 cores, and 12GB of RAM. We also see that Task Manager does know about the RAID volume, so I guess we need to first initialize it. Disk management knows what to do, so let's create one large partition on the RAID volume. Let us test how this is all performing. First at SSD. Which gives us the expected numbers over SATA, then the RAID volume. Which, to my ID, performs pretty well too. Let's have a look at what Geekbench has to say. I did a test run before all the upgrades, and this was the result back then. You can't really call this a race machine with that Xeon W3503 in it. Let's see if this got any better with our upgrades. About 3.5 times as fast with the X5650 and faster memory. That's really nice. As you saw earlier, I replaced the 3x2GB of memory with 4GB modules, rather than adding them together with the 2GB ones. After all, there is room for 6 modules. The main reason for that is because the old ones were not capable of running at 1333MHz, which the Xeon X5650 supports, while the old CPU does not. We can see Windows report these as 133MHz, but this is probably the frontside bus speed. In CPU-Z, we also see our X5650 and the real speed of the memory. 665MHz with DDR, that means 1333. Now to find out if that memory speed really makes a big difference, I added the 2GB modules for a total of 18GB. The BIOS detects this fine and we can see this running at 1066MHz as explained earlier. In Windows, we still see the 133MHz bus speed, but CPU-Z shows 533MHz, which results in 1066 with DDR. I'm curious to see which impact that would have on the performance. Not even 100 points less, so for an additional 6GB of RAM, that might be a good trade-off, I guess. This concludes the video. Thanks a lot for watching. I really hope you liked all of this, and if you did, please put a thumbs up. If you like this kind of content, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel for more of the same. Thanks again, and see you back soon!